Hello, and welcome to the At His Word broadcast. I'm your host, the Reverend Darrell A. Thompson, Sr., pastor of the Bass Street Missionary Baptist Church. And I want to thank you for joining us, taking time out of your schedule to share with us on today. At the At His Word broadcast, our mission is to encourage the saints of God, to lift them up and reassure them that they serve a God who stands by His Word. For if God makes a promise, He is not a man that He can tell a lie. The Bible declares that God's word shall not go forth from Him and return unto Him void. So my brothers and sisters, no matter what your circumstance, no matter what your situation, problem, pressure, or pain, I want you to be assured of this one thing. You can take God at His word. Come now and join us.
My soul was sinking in a world of sin, but grace and mercy, it took me in. Took my feet out of a miry clay and placed it on a rock to stay. Oh, what a relief it was when God rescued me.
He put the chains and
had me bound, and then He set me free. Felt like
cooling water,
just like
cooling water.
So much pain, couldn't see no sunshine, nothing but rain.
I said,
we'd been made and do for a night, but in the morning it will be all right.
Oh, what a relief it was
when God rescued me.
He took the chains and
had me bound, and then He said,
found in the book of Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. And when you find it, we're going to ask that you would stand in reference to the holy word of Zion. Amen. Matthew chapter 5. And we're going to start at verse 1. and read through 12. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
And we're asking, amen, if you're able and the Lord has given you legs that can still stand, we want you to stand on them. Amen. As you give reverence to God and his word. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Read with me, amen, starting at verse 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into the mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteous' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Amen. Amen. We're going to. I want to talk to you today real quickly. Amen. I want to use from a thought. Amen. The Christian is different. Look at somebody and just tell them the Christian is different. Okay, look at someone else and tell them the Christian is different. Amen. I couldn't help but to notice the Republicans, amen, as they're having their town hall meetings and debates, and they're trying to stick out beyond their fellow running mates. They're all trying to stick out to win votes. But here is the problem I have with them. How can you stick out when you're the same? I wish I had some help in here. It's hard to be different when you're the same. And my brother and sister, truth is, even with us, it's hard for us to say that we're one thing, but our actions say we're just like everybody else. Our communication says we act just like everywhere. I know sometimes I tell people I'm Christian, but the truth of the matter is, I'm just like everybody else. And I'm here to tell you today, my brothers and sisters, when you are a true child of God, when you have truly been born again, that there are some things that ought to have changed. I've heard so many times people say, this is just the way I am. But I've discovered this, watch this, according to Isaiah, it was the I ams and I wills that got Satan kicked out of heaven. So those who insist on this is the way I am, I didn't say it. I'm just telling you there ought to be a change in your life if you are truly a Christian. There ought to be something that people can look and say, she's different. He don't act like everybody else. He may be in the crowd with them, but he don't act like them. Because a child of God ought to be different. Look at your neighbor and tell them you ought to be different. Just because everybody else is cussing. Just because everybody else is living all kind of ways. My brothers and sisters, there's a word we need to understand, and that is different. Because actually, let me just say it like this. It's okay to be different. We live in a world where everybody wants to be the same. The children walk around trying to look the same. Everybody sees somebody wear something, they want to wear it too. Because everybody is trying to fit in. But God has sent me to tell somebody today as his child, you ought not fit in with the world. In other words, let me just help somebody. Let me say it like this. When you walk into a room, does the conversation change?
they keep on doing and saying what they were saying? Do they not see the God on you? Do they not see the God in you? Or even yet, do you change the conversation when you walk into a room? My brothers and sisters, the truth of the fact is that the Christian ought to be different. You ought not walk like everybody else. You ought not talk like everybody else. When you show up at a family reunion, they ought to know you saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy. Oh, y'all ain't gonna talk to me now, because I know I'm stepping on some feet right now, and I don't mean to. I'm sorry if I stepped on your feet. Don't just get mad, but get saved, and then it won't bother you as much. But watch this. As we read and study the Beatitudes, we become increasingly aware that there's a big difference, a vast difference between Christians and non-Christians. There is a gap that is between Christians and non-Christians. I did not say between non-Christians and those who put on the act of Christian. But there is a gap between those who say they who are Christians and those who are not Christians. As a Christian, there are some things non-Christians won't ask you to do because they know that you are a Christian. But watch this. There are many ideas as to what constitutes being a Christian. Some people believe that they are saved if they get baptized, join a church, and try to do right and live by the golden rule. But my brothers and sisters, I've discovered this, watch this, that Christians are often compared to a wheelbarrow. They ain't no good unless they being pushed. They're often compared to a kite, always up in the air about something. I wish I had some help in here. They compared to a football, because you can't tell which way they gonna bounce next. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me today. Sometimes they even compare to a balloon because they always full of air and ready to blow up. I ain't talking about nobody. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. Christians have been compared to trailers because they always have to be pulled along. They compare to a neon light. They off and on. They never stable one way or the other. They off and they off. And without a doubt, my brothers and sisters, what I've discovered is the world has come into the church, and the church has become worldly. The church has began to be conformed by the world instead of the world being conformed by the church. But when we look at the Beatitudes, the Lord paints a picture of the difference between Christians and non-Christians. And when I look at this text, watch this, it shows us, first thing it shows us that is that the Christian's object of worship is different. Watch this. When you read the Beatitudes, three of them, they point out the difference that as a Christian, our object of worship is different. Because he says, first of all, watch this, the poor in spirit. Then he says, they that mourn. Right. And then he says, and the meek. Yeah. Because watch this, the non-Christian, he does this. He worships himself. The non-Christian worship themselves. Everything revolves around their own selfish desires. It has to go their way or no way at all. Y'all know anybody like that? I ain't talking outside the church yet. I'm talking about inside. If it ain't going their way, they won't be a part of it. They ain't going to be a behind-the-scene worker. They only want to be the out-front worker. The non-Christian worships and brings attention to themselves. And ultimately, my brothers and sisters, that's what keeps them from becoming a Christian, is their worship of self. Because how can you be a Christian when it's all about lifting up you? In fact, Jesus said, and watch this in Luke chapter 9 and verse 23, Jesus even urges us to deny ourselves. That word denied means to put yourself away of a lesser value than someone else. And my brothers and sisters, you've got to understand that Jesus wants us to understand, stop worshiping you and begin to worship him. Because here it is, a non-Christian sees the world only through their own eyes. Watch this. In New York, Museum of Natural History, they have a Museum of Natural History there. And there was a man who did an experiment. And what he did was he took a room and arranged the room to look from a dog's point of view. And what he did, he took the leg tables and made them look like giant pillars. He took stuff and made it super large because he wanted everyone to see what the world looks like from the perspective of a dog. In other words, he made everything different from what we're used to seeing. What am I trying to tell you? As a child of God, you ought to see things different. I know how mama see it. I know how your road dog see it. But you ought to see it different. You see people looking at it from the negative. But if you a real child of God, you can find the sunshine. You don't care how dark the day is. If you are a real child of God, you understand that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord. They look at stuff different. Because as a child of God, you understand I look at the world as not belonging to me, but belonging to him whom I belong to. And therefore, when I worship, I don't worship me. It ain't about me. That's why I don't get mad if don't nobody call my name. Because when I come to church, it ain't about me. You ain't gotta say nothing, but I'ma still do what I do. I'ma still lift up the name of Jesus. I ain't gonna get no frown on my face. I ain't gonna hide out and say I ain't gonna do nothing, because I ain't raised one person from the dead. I ain't healed in one person. I ain't made one blind person to see. And so guess what? It ain't about me. Because the truth is, I need Jesus just like everybody else needs Jesus. And if I need Jesus just as much as everyone else is, that means I'm just as bad off as you are.
That's right.
The Christian, when he worships, the Christian walks into the church and they worship God. Well, watch this, because when the Christian worships God, he has three steps to total commitment. And it's right here in the text. The first step you'll find that he has is he has realized his spiritual helplessness. He has realized his spiritual helplessness. Watch this, because the Bible said, blessed are the poor in spirit. When you are a true Christian, you recognize that ain't nothing I do in and of myself. The only reason I got up this morning is because God woke me up. I know there's some folks now that alarm clock probably still ringing because they didn't get up to answer the alarm clock. The only reason you have what you have, those clothes you got on, that house you live in, that car you riding in, you didn't get it. You didn't pull yourself up by your bootstrings. It was God that gave you enough sense to tie your strings. I wish I had some help in here. The Christian comes to church and they worship God because they understand I am spiritually helpless. I'm poor in spirit. But watch this. The true Christian worships God because he has expressed sincere sorrow for his sins. He says it right there, blessed are they that mourn. They mourn because they're sorry for making a mistake. They're sorry for messing up. They go through a period of being sorry for rebelling against God. I heard David when he prayed, he said, Lord, forgive me. He said, make me over again. Because I heard him say, for I have sinned against you and against heaven. And my brothers and sisters, he was sorry that he committed the sin. But watch this also. He says here, he has surrendered every part of his life to Christ. That's why the Bible says, blessed are the meek. And you got to understand something. Meek does not mean weak. I think that's what's wrong with most men today. They think when you become meek, that means you weak. No, you still got your power, but what you understand, now I know how to control me. I don't lose myself. I remember who I am. I remember whose I am. And therefore, if God gives me the permission, I can use what I got. But if he don't, then I'm all right with it. He says they are meek. They surrendered every part of their life to Christ. The true Christian, he strives for self-denial. Where the non-Christian strives for self-expression. They've got to express them. Now, I'm going to let them hear what I got to say. They're going to hear my voice. Can you imagine how many graveyards would be empty? How many hospital beds would be empty? If you just learn that sometimes you don't have to express yourself, sometimes you can just hold your peace and let the Lord fight your battle. Can you imagine how many times you've had headaches and body aches because you wanted to get somebody straight? You wanted to straighten some. You ought to let the Lord straighten it out. You ain't got to fight every battle. You stand back and you watch the Lord fight and you get a little smile with. Because what is, they strive for self-expression. They also strive for self-mastery. They strive for self-confidence. You know, it's all about look at what I done. Didn't you see how I put that together? Didn't you know this church won't run without me? They want self-glory. Self-indulgence. Watch this, my brothers and sisters. Self-indulgence. They literally, the only person they can find to brag on them is them. Maybe you know somebody I'm talking about. Every time they talk about somebody else, it's negative. But when they open their mouth about themselves, you think they were Jesus in the flesh all over again. They ain't got nothing wrong with them. They holy from here to heaven. They ain't messed up. They ain't done nothing wrong. They just the pinnacle of what a Christian ought to look like. But when you go to the closet, they all about lifting themselves up, what they want to do, what they want to go, how they want to be. But here, the true Christian is not self-indulgence. It's not self-glory. It's not self-confidence. It's not even self-expression. But the Bible declares it's self-denial. Jesus said, a real child of God, they understand it's not so much what I want, but it's what the Lord wants. Yeah. I heard Jesus say, Father, remove this cup from me, but not my will, thy will be done. And when a Christian learns how to be in a state of self-denial, they learn how to walk closer to God, because there are some things we want to do. Can I just be honest in here? There are some things we want to do. God said, don't do it. There are some things we rationalized in our minds. But God says, I know what you're thinking, and I know how it looks. But if you just don't do it and wait on me, I'll take care of it. But the problem is God don't take care of it fast enough for us, so we start to do it our way. But the Bible declares, deny yourself. You don't have to worry about getting revenge. I am the greatest revenge getter there is, God. God said, stop denying, just deny yourself. Watch this. Not only is the Christian's object of worship different, but according to the Beatitudes, you will discover that the Christian's goal is different. Look at someone and tell them your goal ought to be different. Because watch this. One of the Beatitudes simply says it in this way. It says, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Now, when we read that text, it sounds, when we think hunger, we think of hungry, you know, hungry. But hunger is having a desire. They thirst. They have a desire that pushes them when they normally would stop being pushed. That would drive them when they would normally throw up their hands. They would normally say, that's enough. I've had enough. Anybody in a church like that, the devil will try to convince you to quit, but something won't let you quit. The devil try to tell you you ought to just take a break, but something won't let you take a break. In fact, I heard Jeremiah say, I wasn't going to preach to them folks no more. I ain't have nothing to say. But it was something on the inside that was just like fire set up in my bones. Them people in the choir got on my nerves. I ain't going back. But every rehearsal, I find myself back here. That's because the Holy Ghost won't let me go. I told him I'm going, even if I have to go by myself. Is there anybody ready to go on?
Watch this. Watch this. The Christian's goal is different. But I have to show you first again that the non-Christian's goal is anything that satisfies them. Watch this. They hunger for wealth. They doing whatever it takes to get money. They don't care. They'll say whatever it say. If the producer of the record want me to cuss and call women this and that, I'll do it because it's all about some money. They'll do anything for status. You don't believe me? Look at the reality shows. Look what the young women do now just to get on TV. Just to hear their names on the TV. Look what our people do now just to hear their name even called in the church. They want possession, they want power, they want prestige, and they'll do anything and go along with anybody that will help them get in the worship of themselves, because that's all they care about. But the Christian's goal is different, because this one, the non-Christian, this is their mentality. If they pray at all, if they pray like a little boy's prayer, that was once told, said a little boy got down on his knees and said, Lord, make me good, but not too good. Just good enough to keep me from getting a whooping. And that's how many of us are today. God, make me good, but not too good. Because I still got some bad I enjoy. But Lord, make me good enough where you won't have to punish me. Make me good enough where you won't send me to hell. Make me good enough where it won't cost me anything. And my brothers and sisters, when you are a child of God, your Christian goal is only one thing. And I wish I had some help that says your Christian goal is righteousness. That's all you care about. Above everything else, the true Christian wants to get right with God. It don't mean you don't slip every now and then. It don't mean you don't mess up every now and then. But you ought to at least be in a right relationship with the Lord, that you ought to know his name. He ought to know your name. The problem is, God don't know some of you because you ain't spent no time with him. I know you've been in church. I know you perform in church. You say amen to the preacher as long as he ain't talking about you. But the problem is,